Good morning and happy Valentine's Day. May it please the court, I'm Ken Matfeld of the City Attorney's Office on behalf of the Harbor Department of the City of Los Angeles in its pursuit of insurance coverage for its judgment against Wilmington Marine Services Incorporated. This morning I'd like to highlight the path that the district court followed in its coverage analysis, because I believe that by skipping ahead directly to the pollution exclusions caused a short circuit in the coverage analysis. The structure of a coverage analysis is laid out by the district court in its opinion, like starts on the bottom of page 13. You begin with the insuring agreement. These policies insure against liability for property damage caused by an occurrence to which the policy applies. Now it's the city's burden to establish property damage caused by an occurrence. Then it's the insurer's burden to prove that an exclusion applies, and then it's the city's burden to prove any exceptions to the exclusions. Coverage clauses are interpreted broadly, exclusions narrowly.
Yeah, how about exceptions to exclusions? You didn't get to that part.
Does. He jumps straight ahead.
No, you tell us the standard of review for everything except exceptions to exclusion, and that's what we're dealing with, is an exception to the exclusion.
The exclusion should be construed narrowly. So the structure of the insuring agreement tells us that the occurrence is the cause of the damage, not the damage itself. It's also important to recognize that the act or accident doesn't necessarily has to happen at the same time as the damage. The traveler's policies define occurrence as an accident, including exposure to conditions which result during the policy period in bodily injury or property damage, neither expected nor intended from the standpoint of the insured. So the court should be looking for damage during the policy periods, the 70s and the 80s. But at that point of the analysis, you don't see the court asking, has the city met its burden to prove that contaminants have reached the sediment or the soil in the 70s or 80s caused by an occurrence in the 70s or 80s, you know, within days or weeks or months or even years of that damage occurring. Instead, on page 20 of the opinion, the court elects to proceed directly to the pollution exclusions in most of the policies because it is clear that even assuming coverage, those exclusions clearly bar any coverage. Had the court dealt with the question of an occurrence at that time, it would have had to confront the timeline and the evidence or the lack of evidence specific to the periods during which these policies were in effect.
So can I cut through this a little bit? You've got to show that the pollution was sudden and accidental in order to recover. Is that correct?
Sudden and accidental events.
Okay.
Yes.
Yep.
And as we set forth in our papers, the trial evidence pertained strictly to Wilmington Marine's business practices, its housekeeping, from like 2007 on, to its demise in 2013, the demise of Wilmington Marine. But the policies at issue cover between 1972 and 1986, much as 40 years earlier, when the business was run by Constance Chandler, not Dominic Bilicic, who the insurers like to quote. Also, had the court dealt with the question of occurrence at this time in its analysis, it would have had to struggle with the word accident in the definition of occurrence. But the court doesn't complete the analysis, it skips ahead. And I believe that's how the district court was able to be so dismissive of the city's evidence of intervening acts between the deliberate act of Wilmington Marine in prepping and painting boat bottoms and the resulting contamination of soil and sediment. Remember, boat repair happens on dry land.
Let me try to cut to the chase a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because, like, to me, in reviewing this case, it seemed like the district court's analysis, really everything stemmed from the litigation decision that the city made in the Superior Court trial, right? You chose a certain theory to maximize the recovery, and so the district court basically worked off of that. And now the city, it seems to me, is now trying to pivot and present different evidence in their efforts to seek indemnification. I don't think the case law supports that.
That is exactly the insurer's argument, that there was a pivot. But underlying, in the Superior Court trial, all we had to do was prove that these chemicals came from boat repair, not somewhere else. We did not have to divide the damage into specific policy periods, because now we're in contract, and those contracts cover one-year periods, 72 to 73, 73 to 74. I didn't have to do that in the trial court. And so our evidence that of business practices in 2010 was sufficient for the Superior Court to say, yeah, this was, you know, the forensics of co-location of boat chemicals with PCBs was sufficient to establish that this contamination was caused by boat repair. It didn't have to address the mechanism of release.
So you don't see the inconsistency or contradiction at all in the evidence that you presented and the theories that you advanced before the Superior Court and the supplemental or additional evidence that you are trying to seek to present to the District Court?
Because there was no evidence in the trial court from relevant time periods.
But aren't you using the state court judgment's finding of liability and damages to get insurance coverage?
Yes.
Well, then we have to look at what happened there.
We have to address the exclusion. We have to get to the exclusion, and we have to get to the exception to the exclusion, things that were not addressed.
But I'm struggling with is you're relying on the liability and damages amount from the state court judgment and the evidence you presented, and now you're pivoting and saying just, you know, ignore that when you're trying to get money from the insurance coverage. I mean, it seems like you're stuck with it. That's what you litigated. That's the theory. That's the evidence. And now you got your judgment. You got your, you know, damages, and to collect on it, you're stuck with that.
The judgment finds Wilmington Marine liable for contamination of soil and sediment. Now we have to discuss the mechanism by which that damage occurs and whether that mechanism fits or is barred by the exclusion or fits within an exception to the exclusion. So the question is, how did the district court able to conclude without any evidence or testimony from Wilmington Marine that Wilmington Marine subjectively intended damage to the soil and sediment in the 70s and 80s? Well, how you do that is you jump to the exclusion and you adopt stand-in versus Fireman's Fund. And that's where I believe the short circuit occurs.
When you were in front of Judge Kuhl in the Superior Court, did you anticipate that Wilmington was going to be insolvent and you were going to have to look to its insurer for recovery?
Wilmington was insolvent at that point.
So you knew you were going to have to look to their insurer?
In front of Judge Kuhl. Judge Kuhl's
That's the Superior Court.
Well, yeah,
wasn't it in front of Judge Kuhl? Maybe I'm wrong.
Yes, in 2019, and there's two Judge Kuhl opinions here. There's the judgment against Wilmington Marine. There's also a motion for summary adjudication brought by one of the city's insurers in another coverage case, where Judge Kuhl used State of California.
In the judgment that you're now trying to enforce against
yes.
them,
at
that trial, you knew that you were going to have to look to their insurers?
Yes.
Okay. You nonetheless tried the case on the theory that you did, which is giving you trouble now as you're looking at the insurance policy.
So, yes.
Okay.
Understood. But let's look at the model that the district court chose to analyze the exclusion. Stand-in versus Fireman's Fund. Note that Stand-in's liability was under CERCLA. CERCLA applies liability to owners, to operators, and arrangers of the disposal of hazardous waste. Stand-in was liable as an arranger. Arrangers like basically no fault. The conduct for which Stand-in was liable was simply contracting to have his waste trucked to the landfill for proper disposal. It was not liable for any release from the landfill. So even though Stanton was disposing of his waste in a perfectly legal, permitted way, he became liable for the failures of the landfill operator. That's why the Stanton court tells us the relevant discharge is the initial deposit. Simply transporting the waste creates liability. Just the deposit. And that's why the standard court's irrelevant. The insured, the arranger, didn't intend to contaminate the environment. Arranger liability doesn't require it. Under arranger liability, subsequent and accidental releases after the deposit are irrelevant. And finally, that's why the standing court tells us...
So how does that case have any bearing on what's in front of us?
Because the standing analogy that our district court uses isn't the appropriate legal predicate. It's a ranger model, not an operator model.
No, I get that, but you're relying on the Stringfellow case,
yes.
Which strikes me as you've got two major flooding events arising from two major rainstorms, and Judge Werdiger's opinion for the court says that's sudden within the meaning of the an accidental within the meaning of the policy. We don't have such events here.
But we did offer evidence in the form of an expert opinion from Dr. Greg Douglas, who examined the site, who dug paint chips out of the sediment, who found the path, and he said this waste is heavy, and it takes a flood, something on the order of last week's atmospheric river, or actually flooding caused by tsunamis in the 60s, to wash the yard and cause this stuff to get into the sediment. We had that evidence, and Judge Wu says, I'm not going to consider that. I don't need to consider it because I'm just going to rely wholly on the Superior Court's statement of decision. But that decision doesn't enlighten as to the mechanism of a release, and it certainly doesn't address all the damage.
But then you should have brought that evidence in the state court. Maybe there would have been no liability. Maybe the defense would have been, we actually did a very good job, and except for that once-in-a-generation rainfall we received, the port wouldn't have been contaminated, and then maybe there would have been no liability. But so you can't, get liability by saying they did nothing, toxins were being released everywhere, get the liability, get the damages, and then pivot and say, well, actually, maybe they did a good job. Maybe it would have been all contained in the pavement except for this huge, monsoon that came.
That's why you don't try your coverage case in the liability case.
But you're relying on the underlying state case for the liability and damages and trying to leverage that to get money from the insurers.
Again, all we proved in the state case was that PCB didn't come from snow as travelers suggested, that because we can find PCBs in the soil and sediment, and its concentrations correlate with high concentrations of copper, which is also used in boat bottom paint, this more likely than not came from boat paint and not other sources. We didn't address the mechanism of release. The mechanism of release, which is what the coverage turns on, is what's at issue in front of the district court. When you use an arranger model to direct your focus to the conduct from which liability arises, you end up focused on the wrong conduct. Because generation of paint waste on pavement is not the same as deposit of waste to a landfill. Property damage doesn't occur when you scrape a boat and it falls on asphalt. It's not ultimate disposal. We know that Wilmington Marine was sweeping up the waste. It had to be. If they weren't, it would be knee-deep. Wilmington was not arranging for waste to be deposited in the harbor.
I thought that part of the evidence at trial was that Wilmington really willfully adopted no containment measures. I think at one point there was reference to Wilmington spreading the toxic waste around, like fertilizer, allowing it to just freely flow into the harbor whenever it rained. That's a very specific theory, and there were multiple witnesses that testified to that. So I guess I still don't get why that doesn't relate to the issue that you're arguing today.
That conclusion is the district court's conclusion. He came to the conclusion that there was no effort at containment, which is not the same as deficient efforts at containment. Because if you use an operator model, evidence of good housekeeping is pivotal
So what were the efforts at containment here?
Sweeping up. Housekeeping is the key for boat repair because it's still done the same way. Happens on dry land, scrape the boat, you got to sweep it. If you don't sweep it completely, you get the atmospheric river, you get a flood, it's going to end up in the harbor. If you apply an operator model...
Now, do you need an atmospheric river or just an ordinary rainstorm?
Well, it's heavy. It needs to generate flow. You need a flow rate. That was Dr. Douglas's opinion. You need a lot of water to pick the stuff up from where it lies on dry land and carry it to the ocean. Judge Wu used the arranger model, where, like I said, liability is strict. You transport your liable. Intervening events between the deposit and the resulting environmental damage don't matter. Resulting environmental damage doesn't need to be anticipated. So it's easy for the judge in that case, using the standard model, it's easy for him to conclude that this damage was the result of a deliberate act. The court's actually, you know, we rely, once you get back on page 28, when he gets back to the occurrence analysis, and remember there's three policies, the first three policies, the exclusion is based on if the insured intended or expected the release. Well, he's already identified from stand-in that the act is the act of doing boat repair and dropping paint on the pavement. Well, now, using California cases that deal with sexual assault and child molestation, they say that, oh, well, the damage is like a foregone conclusion from those acts. But that's not what California law says. The possibility that an unexpected and unforeseen intervening event can create an accident has never been foreclosed. I mean, you can see it. The district court actually said as much. It said an accident does not occur when the insured performs a deliberate act unless some additional unexpected, independent, and unforeseen happening occurs that produces damage. We put in evidence of these tsunamis, heavy rainstorms. Court chose not to consider that.
There's no way the city, if they're doing an audit of a company and they're scraping toxic paint and just let it drop onto the concrete and they say, well, we're doing a pretty good job or we're doing an adequate job of containing it. There's no way the city would say, that's okay. There's no way.
It still happens.
And the city's okay with it?
Well,
that's another separate issue.
The city's not an environmental regulator, for one. Two, there's evidence in this case that the EPA did an audit of Wilmington Marine, and there was no citation.
That's a separate issue of our agencies, whether they're doing their job. But I don't think anyone would say that's a containment. It's not putting it into a landfill, a pit or a landfill, just letting it fall into the concrete.
We paint houses the same way. Scrape your garage door, it falls on the driveway.
I don't think there's a water, a port nearby. Well, maybe if you're lucky enough, maybe you're in a waterfront property, but most of us aren't, so.
Anyway, I was just going to conclude and save my last minute. Even Delgado tells us that which the district court cites, that there's room that the law allows for an additional unexpected event to create an accident, provided it occurs after the deliberate act.
Thank you, counsel.
Your Honors, good morning. May it please the court. My name is Dan Kataba. I am counsel for United National Insurance Company in this case. I am taking the first 10 minutes of this appellee's argument. My colleague, Mr. Jack, is counsel for Travelers. He will take the second 10 minutes, so I will try to keep this exactly at 10 and give him the last 10. I would like to start by responding to the points Mr. Matfeld just made and then raise one additional issue that, Judge Wynn, you hit on about containment. Starting with the broad theme of Mr. Matfeld's argument, what he argued before you is that there is no evidence in the Wilmington record of polluting acts during the insurer's policies in the 1970s and the 1980s. He said, I believe he got up here and said, that it was only from 2007 on to the demise of Wilmington Marine those are that's the evidence of polluting acts that are in the record, and that's all that was litigated in the Wilmington case. That is not true. If you look to Mr. Matfeld's own opening argument in the Wilmington trial, it appears starting in the record at page 2048. He specifically told Judge Kuhl that there was not going to be percipient witness testimony before the court, but that did not matter because Dr. Douglas, his expert witness, was going to give such conclusive and persuasive testimony about the nature of the chemicals that were found at the site and in the harbor sediments that he could go back in time and tell you what those chemicals were, what the pollutants were, what time periods they were used during boat repair operations in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. And thus, based on that Mr. Matfeld was going to be able to show the court that from 1962, when Wilmington started operating at that premise, or at those premises, until 2012 when it was evicted, it polluted the site and caused pollution of the harbor sediments the entire time. And the court agreed with that. Judge Kuhl specifically found as a fact that from 1962 to 2012, Wilmington, through its business operations of cleaning boats, of shedding paint, of cleaning out engines, of doing boat repair, caused significant contamination of the site that it leased from the city and of the harbor sediments, and that was the judgment, and that's what it was premised on. So that is why, in this coverage case, we are focusing on the business operations of Wilmington Marine Service, because those were the causal acts of pollution that this judgment rests on.
Let me ask you this, and I probably should know the answer to this already. Was the judgment in the Superior Court based upon pollution into the harbor only, or pollution into the ground at the site as well?
It was based on both. It was based on the initial discharge of pollutants onto the boatyard ground, and that those boatyard pollutants were not contained by Wilmington. They then spread into the harbor. And there's actually a great quote from Mr. Matfeld himself.
I misunderstood you. I asked, is the judgment based on what goes into the harbor and what stays on land? And you said both, and then you just talked about what went into the harbor.
My apologies, Your Honor. Yes, it's based on both. It's based on what is in the harbor polluting the sediments and also on the land and then that seep down into the groundwater at the site. The judgment is based on all of that.
So if, at least as to that stays on land, you don't need a big rainstorm to wash it into the harbor because it doesn't go into the harbor.
You don't.
Yeah, okay.
But it did go into the harbor. I'm sorry, I think I misunderstood your question. The pollution that is discharged directly onto the land, that's what comes from cleaning boats, repairing boats, goes onto the ground at the boatyard. The stuff that stays there, it can get hit by rain. I believe Judge Wynn pointed out during Mr. Matfeld's argument, there's a quote in there about it's like fertilizing your lawn. It seeps down into the groundwater. That's part of it. So there's polluted groundwater. That's part of what Wilmington was sued for. There's pollution all over the boatyard, but there's also pollution in the harbor waters down into the sediment. And so that comes from the boatyard pollution that gets washed into the harbor. As to that, what we have from Mr. Matfeld in his opening argument in the Wilmington trial, this is on page 2048, line 27 of the transcript. He told the court, he said, "Today, we're going to show the court that over the course of 50 years of operation, Wilmington Marine Services released or otherwise failed to contain hazardous wastes that are generated by its boat repair operation." We go to his closing argument after all the testimony he adduced at trial. This is page 1930 of the record, and it starts at line 25 of this transcript page. "Mr. Matfeld, so the city is asking that the court find Wilmington Marine Services liable for the contamination of soil, groundwater, and sediment at berth 162 on account of its release and failure to contain hazardous waste. And those wastes, shall I say, the waste streams were generated by boat repair, and it's well documented and it's not really disputed." So when Mr. Matfeld got up here and told you guys, told this honorable panel, that there's no evidence in the record that there were releases or polluting events during the insurer's policy periods in the 70s, that is simply not true. The entire case was litigated on the basis that for 50 years, Wilmington Marine polluted its site, did nothing to contain its pollution, and because of that failure to contain pollution, sediments got polluted by runoff into the harbor. It just happened for 50 years. And that's why that is what the judgment is based on. The judgment is a liability judgment for 5 decades of pollution.
So what if we have evidence that in severe rainstorms, some of this pollution will wash off into the harbor? That pollution, is that sudden and accidental?
It is not. The
Why?
Reason it is not, and it is not the same as the State of California case. It's the Stringfellow case that you mentioned in Mr. Matfeld's argument. In that case, the reason that was deemed sudden and accidental is because that was a new polluting event. And the reason why is that the insured in that case, the State of California, was being held liable for a release from a specifically designed containment facility where chemicals that were dumped by polluting corporations in a specifically designed facility to hold those contaminants.
I understand the facts of that case.
Okay.
And I don't think that the definition of sudden and accidental is an identity function with what happened in Stringfellow. That what happened in Stringfellow clearly was sudden and accidental, but there may be things that are a little, as it were, I guess I can say milder, that might also be sudden and accidental. Why is it not sudden and accidental if you have a typical Southern California rainstorm, the kind we get maybe a couple of times a year, that washes into the harbor? Why is that not sudden and accidental?
The reason, Your Honor, is that on a sudden and accidental exception to a pollution exclusion, according to Standen and then the Stringfellow case, State of California, the focus is on the release that gave rise to liability for the insured. So the release that gave liability to this insured, Wilmington, is its initial releases through its business activities. Then, because we get to the issue of failure to contain, and that is key to this issue, is that when you have discharges onto the ground that are not contained, any further spreading of the pollution that's on the ground into the broader environment, per Standen and then State of California, is not another release. That is not a polluting event by which the pollution exclusion is analyzed.
I don't buy that one. So if I don't buy that distinction, why is it not sudden and accidental? I put it somewhere. I count on the ground to contain it. The ground doesn't work. It washes off.
Well, Your Honor, when you say you don't buy it, what the State of California specifically says is that the issue is whether or not it is intended to be contained. So when you discharge into the environment directly without any effort in containment, which is specifically the theory that the city litigated the underlying case on, further spreading through other events is not a sudden and accidental release because it is not a release at all. It's just further instance of property damage. So there has to be intended containment and then a release from that state of containment in order to be a sudden and accidental release, because otherwise it's not a polluting event that matters at all to a pollution exclusion. That's why.
Is there no evidence at all in front of Judge Kuhl of attempts to contain? It clearly was inadequate. But there's no evidence of any attempt to contain or mitigate?
And I realize that I'm coming up on my time, so I'll try to keep this short, although I have a minute and 45 seconds. There is no evidence to contain other than Wilmington Marine installing two concrete interception berms to catch wastewater in 1995, which for purposes of these policies is legally irrelevant because that's 10 years after the last one expired. So during the policy periods when property damage must occur, no, there is no evidence of containment. And take it from Mr. Matfeld's own words. What he says on page 1930 of the record in his closing argument, so the city is asking that the court find Wilmington Marine liable for the contamination of soil, groundwater, and sediment at Berth 162 on account of its release and failure to contain pollutants. Bottom of page 1931 at line 26, Mr. Matfeld. Now, as for Wilmington Marine's efforts to contain those hazardous wastes and prevent them from contaminating the soil and sediment, check. Well, there is no evidence that Wilmington Marine made any effort at all, particularly before about 95, when it attempted to gain compliance with the Clean Water Act by installing those berms, which the witnesses testified were generally ineffective. So counsel's own argument to obtain the judgment, the evidence that he adduced, the testimony he put on, and the court agreed with this, was that there was no effort to ever contain pollutants until 1995, which does not matter for these policies. So yes, when you ask, was there any evidence of containment, the answer is no, not as it affects coverage in this case. None whatsoever. I have 20 seconds left. I have one other note I just wanted to say. I heard Mr. Matfeld say in his argument that there is no evidence that Wilmington Marine subjectively intended damage to the soil and sediment. I would just like to note for the panel, that is legally irrelevant for a pollution exclusion. The focus is on the nature of the release, not the intent to cause damage. So it's whether the polluting event itself, the discharge, was sudden and accidental, whether the pollution was intended, that is not relevant. That doesn't matter. Thank you,
counsel.
Good morning. May it please the Court, Everett Jack appearing on behalf of the Travelers appellees in this matter. And Travelers joins in the arguments that Counsel for United National just made. I have 4 points I want to address, but first I'd like to address the questions that the Court was asking about discharges from rainwater. And the evidence put forward in the record was that it was sufficient to discharge waste from the operations merely via rain and boat washing on the site. That waste would run into the water. So it didn't require a storm event. This was the record before the trial court. It did not require a storm event for that to occur. And in fact, the reason that the berms were installed in 1995 was because they knew that waste was running into the water, and that was a mechanism as an effort to try and stop it after 40 years of operations. First of all, I just want to address my first issue, is that this is not a duty to defend case. This is a duty to indemnify case. So the broad potential for coverage arguments that you might ordinarily hear on cases like this do not apply here. And in this instance, what we're actually interested in is the actual liability imposed on Wilmington Marine based on the claims and theories presented by comparing the judgment against the policies in question. And I want to next address the record in the trial court. At trial, the city chose to pursue a deliberate business operations, resulted in discharge, resulted in contamination over 50 yards from business operations, causing contamination to the soil and the sediment and the groundwater, like lots of other boatyards. And the city went all in on this business operations discharge by dismissing all of their negligence claims before the trial of this case. So they went to trial without any negligence claims at all. During the judgment by Judge Kuhl, then made detailed findings and conclusions, none of which were appealed, and therefore are all verities for the liability at issue in this case. They included Wilmington Marine's operations for 50 years on the site, that waste discharged by Wilmington Marine's boat and repair maintenance operations contaminated the soil, groundwater, and sediments, that the contaminations at issue were used in marine paints from 1948 until 1989, and there were high levels of those contaminants in areas where Wilmington Marine historically performed boat operations, that based on the chemical composition of the contaminants and the co-location testimony from Dr. Douglas, Wilmington Marine's boat repair activities from the 1960s to the 1980s were the cause of the contamination, and that Wilmington Marine's first effort at any containment was 1995 when it installed the berms. The conduct for which liability is imposed and coverage is to be determined are those facts that the court found. Now, in the city's reply brief, they make a statement that if this court determines that these deliberate business operations are that discharged waste into the environment, namely the stripping of paint, sandblasting of paint, washing of hazardous materials from ship hulls, is the relevant discharge, that there is no need to talk about an accident because that is not an accident, and therefore there would not be any coverage. So what Mr. Matfeld then focused on with you this morning was whether or not there was a relevant discharge event. And I think preliminarily it's important to recognize that the judgment identifies really only a single discharge event, and that is Wilmington Marine's decades of boat repair operations by which pollutants were deliberately discharged in that process into the environment, causing contamination to the site, both the soil, the groundwater, and the sediments. And the declaration offered by Dr. Douglas in this case was the first claim of some subsequent discharge as a result of a failure to contain. Mr. Matfeld talked about...
Were the insurance companies defending in the trial court under duty to defend?
Yes, sir. Actually, Travelers appeared to provide a defense, notwithstanding the fact that the insured failed to appear and failed to cooperate in the defense. Mr. Matfeld has talked a little bit about the Standum case, and the City of Los Angeles case, and what is the right analysis for considering the discharge that should be evaluated by the court. The Standum Decor, the Standum decision, and the State of California case both apply exactly the same analysis to what is the correct discharge event to consider. And in each case, the court concluded that the relevant discharge is the one that is alleged to be the basis for the liability or which the judgment is based against the insured. So in the Standum case, the liability against the insured was for the delivery of waste to the site, and so therefore the delivery of the waste to the site was the relevant discharge. In the State of California case, the allegation was that the state allowed the waste to release from a containment facility, and therefore that was the reason and the discharge that was relevant for those purposes. Here in this case, the city's entire theory of liability and basis for liability in the judgment was that Wilmington Marine was liable for damages as a result of discharge to the site from pollutants as part of its regular and routine business operations over 50 years, as evidenced by the co-location evidence and the high levels of contamination in areas where they conducted those boat repair operations. In short, there should be no dispute that it is those business operations that the city pursued as the means of release, and Mr. Matfeld recognizes that if that is in fact the appropriate discharge, there is no accident because regular business operations cannot constitute an accident under a general liability policy, and therefore there would be no coverage. I could speak about a lot of other things, but I'd rather find out if the court has any questions that I'm not answering.
We have no further questions.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you for your argument.
The Standum Court actually distinguishes Montrose Chemical as the proper, as different, because it involved releases from an operation at the insured's place of business. Standum distinguishes arranger liability from operator liability. It distinguishes its choice of relevant discharge from State of California, which is an operator model. We did argue that releases and failures to contain caused the contamination. Chemical of concern in this case is PCB. PCB was invented in the 30s, outlawed in 76. In order to get liability for PCB, we had to argue that releases occurred in the 60s, in the 70s, when PCBs were widely in use as a plasticizer for marine paints.
True, as was represented in the argument from the other side, that the first attempt to contain was the installment of those berms?
Because they're using this construct that pavement, concrete, asphalt, is not a containment.
Right. Okay.
And that's a construct that allowed the district court in this case to back into Standum. He said that release is the generation of waste through boat repair, the legitimate business. That business was a deliberate, the deliberate act is conducting the business of boat repairs.
Okay,
right?
It. Thank you.
In the trial court, we said, yeah, releases and failures to contain, but we never said intentional. We never said sudden and accidental mechanisms. We never talked about expected or intended damages. We just said these chemicals, PCBs in particular, are associated with boat paints used in the 60s and the 70s. Again, when Your Honor challenged Mr. Catabaugh on the pavement issue, he jumped right back to Standum, the arranger liability, where expectation of damage is of no matter, subsequent releases don't matter, liability is strict. And that's the model that the district court uses find that there's no accident.
All right. Thank you very much. Our questions took you over time, but I appreciate both sides for your argument today. The matter is submitted. And that's our last case on the argument calendar this morning. We're in recess until tomorrow morning. Thank you.
All rise. This court stands in recess till tomorrow morning.
Thank you.